I'm excited to share my presentation called Four Decades of Life with you. There's a great saying that says, teach what you want to learn. In this process of reviewing my life in decades gave me a lot of insight. I highly recommend taking the time to do that in your own life. So a room called Remember, Four Decades of Life. I'm going to start out tonight's talk with a favorite quote by an author I read often in my late 20s and rediscovered this past year in a book group I've been a part of every Sunday morning since the pandemic started. The author is Frederick Buechner, and this comes from his book called A Room Called Remember. But there is a deeper need yet, I think, and that is the need, not all of the time, surely, but from time to time, to enter that still room within us all, where the past lives on as a part of the present, where the dead are alive again, and where we are most alive ourselves to turnings and to where our journeys have brought us. The name of the room is Remember, the room where with patience and with charity and with quietness of heart, we remember consciously to remember the lives that we have lived. Tonight, since our theme is decades, I decided to follow his advice and enter the room called Remember and tease out one memory from four decades of my life that have led me to stand here before you today. And as I lead you through this journey, I believe this process is really at the heart of the work that you all do with your clients. You are helping them enter rooms of memory by seeing photos again for the first time, or hearing a parent's voice when a video is converted. In this space, in this virtual space alone, there are countless stories of clients who have cried when you have returned their photo collections in a way they can experience those memories again. You open a door to a room called Remember. And as we go on the next few days, I'd love to hear about what room you would enter if you were to give this talk. So over these next few days, feel free to tell me a story or two and make sure you share that with one another. Okay, ready? Here we go. This first story is actually a much better story of the how and why I have such a passion for stories and photos. Any of you who have listened to the podcast or read my biography know that I say that I got started telling stories from photos when my adopted son was born and because I wanted to tell his story of how he came to be part of our lives. That is how I discovered scrapbooking, which is completely true, and it's a great two-sentence soundbite. But often our stories are more complex than a soundbite, but most people don't have the time for that. I'm now going to tell you a more complex and longer story of how I came to understand the power of photos and stories in my 20s. I'll also share shorter stories from my 30s and 40s and conclude with an overview of my 50th decade, which is comprised of 10 conferences. As I write this, I realized how much of my life in the past 10 years has revolved around planning and delivering a conference in the spring. There's a lot of years, and you'll see the changes in the photos that I'll be sharing at the end. And you'll probably see some of yourself as well. So join me as I enter this first room called Remember, remembering life in 1988 at age 28. It was a warm spring day, and I had invited a group of friends to my house for lunch. Stanley Shipp, a minister and influencer teacher for many of my friends at the time, was visiting from Texas, and he always had fascinating stories to share of his travels and the people he had met. I was 28, and my title was local sales manager for the independent TV station with the call letters WTXX. I had joined the TV station shortly out of college when cable TV was still in its early stages. My job was to sell advertising to local businesses. I actually would drive up and down busy retail streets and go door to door, encouraging people to sell their products on our TV station. And I would talk about the power of telling their business story using videos. After a few years, I was promoted and became the first woman sales manager in Connecticut. I was responsible for a large budget and a team of 12 account executives. I had a company BMW and a great income. Every summer, I would save my money and travel. One year it was to Spain and Portugal, another Germany and Austria, another Italy and Greece, another France. I love taking photos and creating photo albums and framed prints for when I returned. Sitting around that table, Stanley shared that a group of college students had approached him with an interest in starting a church in another country. He shared how he was creating a 3-month discovery trip around the world to expose them to different cultures and experiences to help them determine where they should go. My eyes lit up with excitement, and I later approached Stanley with this proposition. Can I go along to photograph and write about the trip experience? And he said yes. I asked for, so I wrote a letter to my bosses, leading with, "The unexamined life is not worth living," my favorite quote of mine by Socrates. I asked for a 6-month leave of absence with the plan to finish my master's degree that summer and then travel from late August to November. If they said no, I said I was resigning. They didn't say no, they said yes. Now remember, that was 1988. Some of you may not even have been born yet, and many of you were probably just young kids. There were no cell phones, no internet, and only film cameras. At my office, they actually had a map of the world and a cutout of my face that they moved based on my itinerary. So off I went, completely unaware that I was about to experience something that would rock my world and leave a lifelong impact on my worldview. Here we are in St. Louis right before the departure. Now, as you can imagine, there are many stories to tell from that experience, but how that brings me here today, always stressing that we are a people of stories and that our stories are told through photos, is this. Nothing had prepared me for the level of poverty, pollution, disease, and despair that we were to encounter. My photo theme was going to be window boxes of the world, because I love taking photos of the different doorways in windows of Europe. I didn't know that there would be no window boxes in the slums of Calcutta, where we met Mother Teresa, or that most people go to Kenya as a start to a wildlife safari. Just out of sight is a slum that, when translated, means garbage heap with senseless noise. When I returned home, heartsick and homesick, I couldn't wait to process my experiences. Yet I quickly found that after a few minutes of "how was your trip," most people stopped paying attention. Meanwhile, I was trying to make sense of the inequalities of the entire world. In fact, I was just a month or two back in the US and having a really hard time with reentry. At my job, we had tickets to a Mike Tyson championship fight in Las Vegas. And as the sales manager, it was my job to take our clients and entertain them. I was so conflicted between the excessive Vegas and the poverty I've seen, and I had no way to express those feelings and little empathy from my bosses that I didn't want to go. At that time, I was also finishing my master's degree in humanities, and my final project was to write a thesis paper. I decided to write about the world trip, and I always recall the day I visited my advisor in her home. I walked in and she was calm and quiet, and she listened to my stories. And she made a powerful suggestion. Don't rush this process. Why don't you go home and view your photos and see if a theme arises? What were you drawn to most? What stories do your photos tell? So I followed her advice. I went home and spent hours with the slide carousel looking at the photos I had taken. And soon I discovered a common theme. I was taking photos of women and children. Now, because I worked at the TV station, I had access to the TV studio. I worked with a film editor and re-recorded a 45-minute video of my photos and stories set to music. I called it Women and Children of the World. And suddenly, I had a way to make sense of my experiences and share that with others. I shared that video many times in many different settings, and I discovered the power of photos and stories told in a narrative format. And that was what eventually helped me reorder and make sense of what I had experienced. Here is the opening of that video. This is my room called Remember in 1984.
Sitting in a chalet high in the Swiss Alps, the sun filters through the window and warms me. So many emotions and thoughts run through my mind as I try and summarize the past 3 months of my life. I keep asking, what have I learned about myself, the world, people, God, religion, and what am I going to do about it when I return home? There is one word that keeps coming to my mind, Contrasts. The world is full of contrasts. Here in the Alps, I am surrounded by unbelievable beauty. A fire crackles in the fireplace. The mountains rise majestically upward, looking more like a photograph than real. The air is cool and clean. The pastures are green. Fat brown and white cows graze on hillsides, their udders full of the rich milk that makes the famous chocolate and cheese of Switzerland. The trees are changing. Frost lies heavy on the ground, and the sound of cowbells fills the air. I'm spending 4 days here, thinking, reflecting, meditating, and summarizing what I've learned and experienced on my trip around the world. As my mind wanders back and I reread through my notes, this moment stands in such contrast to the dirt and pollution of Manila, the homeless in Calcutta, a man with leprosy, a disease that does still exist. Stands in contrast to mud huts in Kenya, Buddhist temples and Hindu statues, the hatred in Israel, the thrill of Paris, and the billions in China. The goal of the following presentation is to show what I've learned about myself, people, and God as I travel through 12 countries of the world. My objective is to not present a travel itinerary, country by country, but rather to give you a glimpse of the world I've seen. The emphasis is on women and children, since their conditions and struggles impacted me most.
Okay, so that now moving forward, let's enter a different room called Remember. It's 1994. It's 6 years later, and a lot has changed. I'm married. I'm the mother of Joshua, and he is 10 months. And on June 30th, 6 months after he was born, I had given my resignation to the TV station. I was actually at a different station, the top local CBS affiliate, not as a sales manager, but an account executive. My boss had told me that I was not to be distracted by that new baby at home, and he expected me to be fully present at work, including entertaining clients and taking them to dinner and shows. Larry and I ran the numbers, took a big leap of faith, and I walked away. But it was now months later, and I was wrestling with what kind of job or career could I pursue that wasn't in a sales environment. I was hoping to bring in enough money for a car payment, since our two-door Honda wasn't cutting it with a baby and car seat. I bought a book called I Could Do Anything If I Only Knew What It Was, which was a perfect summary for how I was feeling. I knew I didn't want to fall back into a commission sales job because of the pressure. I wanted flexibility. Isn't that something we all still crave? And I recently reread my writings as I was amazed at the synchronicity of what I wrote then into where I am today. Keep in mind, this is before I discovered the craft of scrapbooking. So over the course of 6 months, I would periodically write in a journal and write a few things. I'm still a big journal writer to this day. So there was questions in the book. Here was a question. What is a dream I have? I wrote, to be able to provide support and information on adoption, infertility, moms transitioning from work to home, help families create adoption books to tell a story. And then a few weeks later, I wrote, take a class in photography to learn to express my feelings with photos. Then 5 months later, I returned to my journal and the exercise was to describe your ideal job and then your job from hell. This was my ideal job, to have freedom, to work with a fun, supportive group of people creating something that is meaningful, to speak, to create video slideshows, teaching, and my job from hell was no freedom or say in my job, punch a clock and sit at a desk all day working with numbers. I am always amazed when I read that because in just a few months, someone would introduce me to a creative memory scrapbook, which gave me a way to create the life book of Joshua, for Joshua that I wanted. And as all of you know, that's usually where the soundbite begins of how I started the photo managers. So now let's fast forward 17 years and enter a room called Remember in 2005. I am 46 years old. It is May, and I have been selling scrapbooking supplies as a creative memories consultant for 11 years. And I have taught hundreds of home parties. How many of you ever attended one of those? You can raise your hand in the chat or give a little emoji, right? People were asked to bring 8 to 10 photos from one event, and I'd teach them how to make scrapbook pages, stressing the importance of adding stories to the pages. I also had the same strong entrepreneurial streak then that I have today. Home parties just weren't enough. I love creating large crop to you drop events. In 2005, the Connecticut Convention Center was just completed. I coordinated with 60 other consultants, Karen Osborne is in this room probably, to invite their customers to join us for a weekend crop to you drop event. For 2 days, over 1,800 people dragged their bags of photos and supplies to the convention center and worked on their photo albums. We gave away prizes, had chair massages, food, music, and classes. Even then, I would wander around that large room and I knew that something important was happening. This wasn't just a bunch of women cutting out photos into cute shapes and adding stickers. This was about community, connection, and sharing. At each table, people would stop and hold up a photo and often tell a story, and the others would just listen. It was confirmation what I had learned 25 years earlier. We take photos to tell stories. It's deeply personal and important. My team sales that year were over $1.3 million. A headline from Business Wire said scrapbook sales will reach $2.3 billion. None of us could have imagined the headline just 9 years later, another headline that would say scrapbooking is dead. So here we are today, right? The way we take photos has changed, but not this desire to show, share, and tell stories. Now for my final room called Remember. This is our 10th conference. And of course, there's a story here. In fact, I tend to downplay that we've had 10 conferences until I was talking with a coach of a leadership brag program I'm currently enrolled in. Shelley Warren said, that is no small undertaking. Very few businesses have a history of 10 successful conferences. She helped me stop and realize that yes, this is an accomplishment and it's required a lot of dedicated time and effort year in and year out. When I started the Photo Organizers, I knew I wanted to have a conference. This likely came from my experience I had attending Creative Memories events and hosting large scrapbooking events for hundreds of people. I always knew that connection happens in community. But I had no experience in creating a conference. What if nobody comes? What if I lose money? What if it's a big flop? As I wrestled with those decisions, I was invited to a 3-day insider training led by Tori Johnson, who's now on Good Morning America. But then she hosted events around the country called Spark and Hustle. She promised to share her playbook on how she hosted wildly successful and profitable events. The cost was over $5,000 plus the hotel. That was a huge investment. I thought long about it and decided that if I said yes, I would earn that money back. And so I did it. There, I gained confidence that yes, it was possible. I got ideas on how to get sponsors and how to price it and offering advanced training opportunities. I was in. So that brings me to a favorite quote I say a lot lately when people compliment me on what a great idea I had to start the Photo Managers. I laugh because the implication is there, we are new, but in reality, we are a 12-year overnight success. So now for this final room called Remember, here is the visual story of 10 years of conferences, which is also your story. Those of you who have attended, and a new story for those of you who are here for the first time. Enjoy this trip down memory lane. That makes me emotional watching that again. My goal was to sneak in the more recent Denver pictures and pictures of you all, but I learned to accept my limitations and can't do everything. So, but I would love to add those in. Oh, Amy, I'm glad you're here. I love that photograph of you. And so I hope you enjoyed that, a room called Remember, right? Because each of us, if you look back at the trajectory of your life and think about your the moments that brought you to where we are today, I bet there are lots of key moments that connected you to this passion that we all have for telling stories.